You're listening to The Word on Ujima Radio 98 FM. Good afternoon, how are you doing today? Hope you are well and enjoying the lovely spring weather that we're almost having. Not quite, spring's nearly here. I believe the clocks go forward. Yes, they go forward this weekend. Oh my days, I cannot wait. The dark and gloom of winter is finally over. Anyway, it's good to be back in the hot seat. Hi, I'm Miranda, here through till 4 o'clock. Hope you can stick around and join me. We kicked off today's show with an incredible tune. Of course, we all know who it is. Do I even need to say who it was? It was, of course, Bob Marley and Redemption, the song. Yes, what have we got on the show for you today, guys? We've got a wicked show, wicked show, wicked show. We have got lots of amazing guests coming on today. Must say hello to Tom, who's in the studio, who's filling in for Joanna and filming, as you can now watch The Word on YouTube. Yes, indeed, I have my own YouTube channel. I'm getting with the kids, man. I'm getting with the kids. So make sure you check out my new YouTube channel, which is called The Word with Miranda. So yeah, coming up on today's show, we meet with journalist and broadcaster Ivan Jackson, who, amongst a million other incredible things, the recent thing he's done he wrote an article about changing the name of Colston Hall, but it really spurred this outpour of national media interest that we've noticed been going on over the last few weeks about changing the name of Colston Hall. So we're going to meet him. He also does an incredible show called Shout Out, and loads of interesting thing, plus he's being put up for a diversity award as well, which will be announced tomorrow. So looking forward to meeting Ivan very soon. We're also going to meet an incredible woman, an athlete, model, trainer, professional fitness, nutrition and behavioural coach, and that's Phoenix Liberty Rain. And then finally today on the show, we have Dr. Marie Mulvie-Roberts, who is an author and a lecturer and a bit of an expert on Angela Carter, who is just, I mean, how would I describe Angela Carter? She's like a seminal English novelist her books are just incredible. Company of Wolves, you might know that, The Bloody Chambers. She's kind of rewrote fairy tales and brought them up to date and a bit scary and rather fab, and she spent some time in Bristol, which I didn't know. So we're going to speak to Marie Mulvie-Roberts later on about that, and of course we'll intermix it with a bit of music, a bit of chat, a bit of gossip, and speaking of which, let's have a bit of Suv. We love a bit of Suv. Suv Mobo Award winner and Mercury Prize winner Suv. This is a track he's done in collaboration with Donnie, who's playing in London tomorrow night. This is called Gotta Da Love. You're listening to The Word on Ujima 98 FM. Enjoy.
The Word with Miranda, your information gateway.
Absolutely loving that track. As I said, that's DJ Suv Mobo, a Mercury Prize winner, Bristol born guy. Absolutely love him. That's from his latest album, Warrior Head Charge, which you can only get from me, which I do rather like that. He said, right, Miranda, you can have the copies. If anyone wants it, they've got to get in touch with you. So you can get in touch with me on Facebook, or I guess you could text me. But I'm not going to give you the number. No, I'm joking. It's 07960240198, the usual Ujima number. So you're listening to The Word on Ujima 98 FM. Hi, here till through about 4 o'clock today. So stick around and join me. We've got a wicked show coming up very soon. We're going to meet Ivan Jackson, a journalist and broadcaster, and we're going to have a chat about all sorts of things. So we're going to take a little bit of a break, pay some bills, and we'll come back and meet Ivan Jackson.
The Word with Miranda, your information gateway.
You're listening to The Word on Ujima 98 FM. Good afternoon, how are you doing? Thanks for joining me today. That was an awesome little track from Mr. Roots, and it's called Herb's Secret. Joining me now in the studio, absolutely delighted to meet Ivan Jackson, presenter and broadcaster on BCFM and on Radio Bristol, and an incredible podcast called Shout Out, and all sorts of wonderful things you're involved with. Hi, Ivan. Thank you for joining me.
Hello, Miranda. It's great to be with you. I do have my fingers in a lot of pies at the moment. This is the
thing. I wondered what you were going to say.
Also, the master of innuendo as well. There you go.
Absolutely. Lovely to have you today. Now, you did come to my attention recently because you wrote an article for a local publication online and, what do you call them? Newspapers these days, don't you? God, I forgot what they're called.
Printed, yes.
You know.
Not many people buy them, do they?
I know. So that was for 24/7, and it was an article about Colston Hall. And this article seemed to spur and incredible about a national outpour of media interest into renaming Colston Hall. Why in particular was this of interest to you?
Well, I've always been a champion of equality, and I spotted they were sort of like touting for interest on Facebook. This is Bristol 24/7, and I happened to comment, and Martin Booth, who's in charge, the big boss there, yeah. He got in touch with me and said, well, I'd like to write an article about what I thought about the Colston Hall and the latest opportunity, I guess, its 150th anniversary, in order to change its name, and should we change its name?
And how do you feel about that?
Very definitely the name needs to be changed. I mean, I've used the word toxic before. You know, they the council and the Bristol Music Trust want some sort of sponsor there in order to raise funds for the hall as well. So it's the perfect opportunity to change the name. Why they haven't done it before, I don't know. But they have an opportunity now to also get some money in at the same time as well by changing that name and getting a sponsor.
Yeah, I mean, I was just going to ask, why do you think they haven't done it before now? Do you think it is purely financial?
I think if you took a random poll in the city, and this is my own opinion, it was an opinion piece I wrote,
of course,
my own personal opinion. I would say about changing the name, you get a lot of anti-change the name and pro-change the name, and I reckon it's probably about 50-50 across the city, but within minority communities, I reckon there's a huge majority of people that want to see that name change. And actually, it's those people that the name affects the most, and they should have the loudest voices, and their opinions should be heeded.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I'm supposed to sort of remain neutral, but I find it incredibly offensive.
It's community radio, so I
yeah,
don't think you have
no,
to be, do
I, you? I absolutely, toxic, offensive, disturbing, those are all words that, you know, spring to mind. 25 years I've been feeling passionate about this and campaigning for a name change for Colston Hall. I don't know if you're aware, in Leeds, they named a hall after Jimmy Savile. Savile Hall.
That's right.
And obviously what happened, within 6 months, they changed the name. Of course, they weren't going to leave it as Savile Hall, were they?
Well, of course.
So how do we justify this? I did an interview recently on Made in Bristol, and there was a guy sat next to me who was about to be interviewed about something completely different. And he wanted to know, well, why does it matter? Does it really matter? And I said, well, you know, if your family had been kidnapped and tortured, and would you not be slightly offended by a hall being named after them? What if it was Jack the Ripper Hall? And he started to think about it and goes, yeah, well, you're absolutely right. And it's just making people think, isn't it?
It does make people think. And I think one of the arguments that I hear against name change, to put the other side, is that we'd be airbrushing history, getting rid of our heritage.
Absolutely, yes.
Well,
yes.
You know, at the end of the day, it's not about airbrushing history. It's about making history and actually showing that in 2017, with the help of hindsight, we can look and say, actually, this isn't appropriate now. It probably wasn't appropriate then, 150 years ago, but they went ahead with it because the people that had the influence had the money, so they could call it what they liked when the building was built. Obviously, the land was owned by Colston originally. And now in 2017, we've got the opportunity to put that right.
I'm really glad you brought that up, because that has been a great source of conversation about, you know, if we change the name, are we going to forget about what's happened? And I think that, you know, Black history is something we need to talk about and should be discussed more in schools anyway. So I feel incredibly passionate about changing the name, and I feel quite hopeful that it's going to happen. Now, I hear you've spoken to some of the Music Board Trust.
Well, I haven't spoken to myself, but I did take part in a phone-in on John Darvill's show on BBC Radio Bristol, and I did hear Louise Mitchell reading between the lines. She is the chair of the Bristol Music Trust,
saying that
name change is going to happen. I get that impression that's going to be the case. I think they'd find it very difficult to keep the name. Now, the reason for that name change might be financial, which strikes me as a little bit morally wrong, because as you said, they've had years to change this name. They could have done so before. Now they've got a chance to rake in a bit of cash and a bit of sponsorship from, you know, any company, national company, phone company or whatever.
Well, this is it. You know, what if it's going to be Tesco's Hall? Well, can you imagine? I'm being flippant, and I know the board of trustees at Colston Hall are a lovely bunch of people, and they really are genuinely nice people, and I am confident they would not let anything like that happen. It is just a shame that it has come down to money.
I think there's an opportunity to use a commercial name, but perhaps use another name as well. So it could be the XY Hall, so to speak.
Yeah,
so there's an opportunity to do both, as long as you get a company that's happy to be associated associated with another name, of course.
Yeah, absolutely. I was wondering if you had, I mean, I don't know if it's like the chicken and egg answer, really. What do you think spurred such national interest at this time when it's a topic that has been discussed for so long?
Well, there's been a number of similar sort of cases in the press, hasn't there, recently? There's been the issue of the Cecil Rhodes statue at Oriel University, Oriel College at Oxford, for example.
Right.
Now, the students there wanted that taken down, that statue, because of Cecil Rhodes' association with the British Empire, with what is now Zimbabwe, of course. They failed. You got the impression that the students obviously wanted the thing taken down. The university kind of backed them, but at the end of the day, they were blackmailed into keeping that statue there because those providing funds to the university said, that statue stays or we withdraw our funding.
Oh, really?
So they made a financial decision the other way round, yes, to what we're talking, yes, about, yes, here today, and not a moral decision.
That's incredible, isn't it? Absolutely, yeah, incredible. And yet, look at the Savile Hall in Leeds. They didn't think twice about it.
Well, exactly. You know, you look globally around the world, and you look at all the despots that have been around the world, yes, such as Mussolini, Pinochet in Chile, I have to say it, Hitler. You know, you don't see any kind of buildings named after these people in those countries, do you? And I'm not conflating Colston with Hitler, although, of course, you know, we're talking about 100,000 people were enslaved, almost directly or indirectly due to the actions of his company. So, you know, at the end of the day, you don't see other countries taking these kind of actions. Any visitor coming to Bristol today would look around and see, this man is rather well overrepresented. And who is he? What do we say to our children? What do we say to visitors when you say, you know, this man is here? Well, he was a philanthropist. Well, maybe, but where did that money come from? And we know where that money came from. It's well documented, and it's always going to be well documented. So there's no way that history is going to be airbrushed out.
Absolutely not. How do you then feel when people always ask me then, what about the other roads like Colston Road and Colston Street and Colston School and Blackboy Hill? And how do you feel then? Would we then need to change everything?
Well, let's I think each case should be taken separately and based on its own merits. With the Colston Hall, that is a publicly owned building.
Exactly.
In other words, those, yeah, of us who pay council tax and business tax in Bristol, we own a chunk of that building. It's ours. It's the public's. So I think we have a good right to say as to how that hall should be named. Now, when it comes to public schools, or private schools, I should say, fee-paying schools,
yes,
they have to make their own, yeah, moral decisions, yeah. Yeah. Their ethical decisions. With street names, again, well, you could argue, where do you stop with the street names? But let me give you another example. For example, there's Bristol Cathedral. We have the beautiful stained glass window in there, but it's dedicated to Edward Colston, of course. And my understanding is the Dean of Cathedral would actually like to see that removed.
That's,
I think,
right,
he's a little bit embarrassed by it. All, yeah, that's stopping them from doing that is the huge cost.
Yes, it's £20,000, well, or even more.
I think it's probably more. And, of course, yeah, nobody's talking about destroying that window. Yeah. Of course, it would be, you know, I think if it was taken out, it would need to be preserved and put in a museum or whatever. But is it appropriate to have that in a place of worship on, yeah, a public display like that?
It gives me such confidence to hear somebody like that actually supporting it and really recognising how inappropriate it is.
I'm not sure whether how his bosses see him, see his decision on that, but you know, I get the feeling that, you know, I'm paraphrasing what I have heard him say, and
yeah,
I get,
no,
the
I've heard him say
case.
Exactly that.
Yeah,
so,
I mean,
you know,
we have of course the other example is the statue that's smack bang in the middle of the city centre, you know, with an ode to Colston, a plaque underneath it, and nothing, no reference whatsoever to his slave trading past. Now, the centre, as you know, we're right by it here,
yeah,
down at Ujima, is undergoing a huge facelift at the moment. That would have been relatively simple to either move the statue, put it somewhere else, or construct some other display next to it. Well, you say blow it up. You know, it's a piece of history, isn't,
yeah,
it? It's a piece of archaeological history, if nothing else. If,
yeah,
you don't value it in any other way,
yeah,
we don't want to go around. I personally wouldn't want to go around destroying things, destroying stained glass windows. But I think there needs to be a history tour, and those items need to be put in proper perspective.
Yeah, no, I agree. Absolutely. Well, we've certainly covered the topic of Colston Hall. Really enjoy speaking to you, Ivan. So don't go away. Stay there,
sure,
if that's all right. We're going to take a little break from the news. We're going to go over to our studios at the BBC for the latest headline news. And we'll be back shortly speaking to broadcaster Ivan Jackson.
The Word with Miranda, your information gateway.
Bonjour, mes amis. Miranda here. How are you doing? You are listening to Ujima Radio 98 FM. I am joined by the very wonderful Ivan Jackson, broadcaster and presenter on, BCFM. And you also do the papers on Radio Bristol, don't you?
Yeah, I was there this morning.
And so you were there this morning. Who's Sherry on John Darvels?
Yes. No, Emma Britton.
Breakfast. Oh, Emma, darling.
Yes, I'm bright and early in the morning.
Oh, my God. How do you get up so early and do the breakfast show? It's always been a bit of a nightmare job. It's one of those things I always want, but I always think, oh.
Do you know, I'm part of the news team on the breakfast show on BCFM.
Yeah.
And it's just one of those things. We're really passionate about local news and local articles, because they're things that don't get covered on, you know, commercial radio stations and on the BBC as well. Because Radio Bristol, remember, covers a huge region.
Yeah.
It's more than Bristol. But we focus on local stories. So I'm really passionate about that. It means me getting up at 4:30 in the morning to start doing the news.
Absolutely. I totally understand. Last year, mortified, I had to turn down two jobs because they were breakfast shows, and as a single mum, it was impossible.
It's tough.
It wasn't in the area either, so it meant moving, so I wouldn't know anybody, so I couldn't blag babysitters for that time of day. I couldn't actually find anyone to pay at that time of day either.
Well, no, exactly.
Shocking, isn't it?
And that breakfast show, it's a zoo format as well, which is what I love as well.
So, I love it.
You know, there's normally 2, 3, 4, 5 of us in the studio.
Yeah, no, I love that.
A lot of banter. And even though it's early in the morning, we wake up very quickly, believe
it's that adrenaline rush gets you going, doesn't it?
It's
absolutely fantastic. I love the breakfast show with Pat Hart and all you guys. It's really good fun. So that's sort of one aspect that you do. You also have a show called Shout Out.
That's right. Yeah.
Explain that to us.
So Shout Out is a show by and for the LGBT community. That's the lesbian, gay, bi and transgender plus community, because there are lots of other people that don't come under those particular
umbrellas.
So we include everybody. And so that broadcasts from BCFM, but goes out live on Glastonbury Radio and Froome FM and a total of 6 other stations across the region. And of course, the show gets podcast as well. We've been nominated for a British UK podcast award, so we're waiting to hear how we've done in that.
That's so exciting. Well done. Congratulations.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, isn't it?
How I was thinking about podcasting, and is it something you can make money out of?
I don't think. Well, of course, we're all volunteers, aren't we? So we don't make any. We don't make any money as far as that's concerned. But the important thing is that it drives. We get a lot of people driven to our website as well, which is shoutoutradio.lgbt. By the way, have a look. You can listen back to any of the shows if you identify as LGBT plus, or even if you don't. Lots of interesting articles that we cover on there.
Now, speaking of interesting articles, I'm absolutely desperate to find out about an interview you did at GCHQ.
I was one of the first journalists to be invited in there because they are very, very pro-LGBT.
Well, remind listeners what GCHQ is, if somebody out there is going, what's GCHQ?
It's the kind of listening ear of the security services.
It's like MI5, MI6,
well, we have MI5,
spies, all of that.
That kind of thing. Yeah. They're the more technical sort of listening communication side of things. So they are very, very pro-diversity in all senses of the word.
Which is interesting when you think about how the forces haven't been in the past.
Course. I mean, if you look at the history of Alan Turing, for example, I mean, he was basically hounded out of the service.
Absolutely.
And of course, ended up dying as a result of the way he was treated and committed suicide. So some absolute stars that have gone in and out of that service. And now, of course, they are very, very open. They were very, very keen to show how diverse they are, and the fact that they openly employ people who are identify as LGBT or plus. Yeah. So I went up there and did an interview. So I was one of the first journalists in there. I had to be specially vetted to go in.
Exciting.
Yeah, I had to submit, which is quite, we don't like doing this, but I had to submit questions that I was going to ask.
Yes.
I had people in the room monitoring what I was saying to this individual, an openly gay man who was I was interviewing.
Oh,
it was amazing. So it went on for 16 minutes. I'll tell you a funny story. It was one of the first interviews I ever did.
Right.
And I got to the end of the interview, and I looked at my recording mic and I hadn't switched it on. I know.
Oh no, you're joking. You poor thing.
You only ever
Oh, I feel sick. I feel sick at the thought of it.
I felt sick as well. We had to do it all again. But because we did it all again, it came out really well. Superb interview.
No, it sounds like an absolutely incredible interview. Did the guy come out When he was working at GCSHQ?
No, because in order to work for the security services, you have to be vetted from the very beginning. So they ask you all about your sexuality, any relationships you've had. They go very, very, very personal,
really?
Intrusive questions they ask when you're employed by them in the first place. They don't care what you... As long as you haven't done anything illegal, they don't care who you are, who you love. They have no interest in that.
Yeah.
The point is that you have to tell the truth and that you can't be blackmailed over anything. So nowadays, there are a lot more sensible about people's lifestyles, and I don't want to say lifestyle choice, we want to be very careful here, about people's sexuality, their gender identity. They do not care, they're not interested in that, they just want you to be honest.
That's incredible, isn't it?
Yeah.
What's the most exciting interview you've ever done?
Most exciting?
Because you've done quite a few, haven't you?
I have done quite a few. I did Helen Scott from the 3 Degrees a while back. She was absolutely adorable.
Wow.
They just released a new album. They're still touring in
They're
touring in the UK at the moment, and they sound wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. But I've done quite a few actors, actresses, and I would call them all actors now, actually. I think they prefer that term now, so that's the thing. I've had a great time. I do travel around the world a lot with my job, which is super, which means I've got access to people that I might not otherwise have access to. And normally when you say to somebody or send them an email, will you do a radio interview, they normally say yes, because it's free publicity, of course, and who says no to that?
Absolutely. I've met a few people that we wouldn't expect to sort of even answer through Twitter and social media, and then the next thing you know, they're on the show. I must apologise for my cold, by the way. Had a rotten couple of weeks, so apologies, listeners, sorry about that. How long have you been a broadcaster and presenter?
Well, you know what, I've only been doing this for 3 years.
Really?
And it was a complete accident. I've been invited onto a radio show to talk about human rights around the world, because I travel around the world and I'd seen and done a lot in my time. And so I'd been on Shout Out, which is the LGBT show, talking about that. And then I was taking part in my first ever demonstration outside City Hall, waving a placard a few years ago. And I called up the station and said, can you get somebody down here with a microphone? I said, because we're protesting the nomination of the Lord Mayor at that time. He was known to have homophobic views, and we didn't want him to be nominated. Of course, the Lord Mayor is nominated by councillors.
Absolutely.
And for the first time ever, they said, no, haven't got anybody available. Get your phone out and interview them. And so that's how it all started, basically.
Right.
And incidentally, that was the very first time Lord Mayor who has been nominated, the nomination has been cancelled. So he was not made Lord Mayor that particular interview.
Oh, well done. That's absolutely incredible.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
So it works. Waving a placard and going to do a demonstration. It works.
It works. No, yes. It's really good to hear. We've only got a few minutes left, and I just wanted to talk about this incredible event that's going on Sunday.
Yes, it's amazing.
10 years of BCFM.
It is, and I think it's just flown. I've only been there for 3 years, but I feel like I'm a sort of cornerstone now. I feel like I'm definitely entrenched as part of the station.
BCFM is our sister community radio station here in Bristol. We do the breakfast show together.
Exactly. We have presenters going backwards and forwards between both stations. So very much a collaboration. That absolutely fantastic. BCFM 10 years old, celebrating those 10 years. We have loads of events going on this month. We've got them going on all year, actually, but at the City Hall on Sunday we will be having a free birthday celebration. But in combination of that, lots of entertainment, by the way, in combination, we will be launching the BCFM Bristol Diversity Awards. Now that's going to happen on Sunday evening too. You can get tickets from Eventbrite. It's free, but you need to register your interest at Eventbrite and just type in BCFM 10. You'll be able to see all the details there. Regarding the Diversity Awards, basically there are a lot of awards that go on all around the city, lots of them. But we're going to bring them all under one, not them, but bring awards under for diversity under one umbrella, so that all of the characteristics that are represented in the Equality Act, for example, sexuality, gender, race, all those people are represented. And we're going to be giving away awards to charities, individuals, organisations, businesses
who have demonstrated
fantastic diversity, diversity in their workforce, and also through the work they do too.
And that's great, because it's still shining a light on a very much needed topic, really.
Definitely.
Isn't it?
Of
you know,
course, yes.
Absolutely. I'm part of an organisation called Sound Women, which is just supporting women in radio and audio, and it's still shocking to see how underrepresented they are.
I wish you'd been nominated. You should have got somebody to nominate you for. But maybe next year, because this is going to be an annual thing. So we've already got City Hall booked for next March as well.
Wow.
So it's going to be taking place every year. So everybody will have a chance to get nominated or nominate their the people they think are most worthy of these awards.
Oh, well, that's fantastic. And I think it's going to be quite a kid-friendly event, isn't it? I'm thinking about taking Top Dog, my son, down.
Yeah, so doors open at 5:30 in the evening. We've got a bit of circus entertainment. We've got a magician wandering around. And during the ceremony itself, the birthday celebrations, we've got some live acts and some music playing as well. So lots going on.
Oh, it's
going
to be fab. And I take it Pat Hart and Sherry will be down there and all the usual BCFM presenters.
You can guarantee it. I think all of us are going to be down there, to be honest. So if you've heard us on the radio, come and meet us. Come and say hi.
Do you find people, when they actually meet you, react quite differently and think you're going to look different to what you actually do?
It's funny. Do you know what? Because I've done a bit for Made TV as well, Made in Bristol TV as well. I've been on there a few times doing various bits and pieces. And somebody, for the very first time, a couple of weeks ago, I was at a do-over at the Arnold Feeney, and somebody came up to me and said, "Oh, I know you. I know who you are. You're off the TV, aren't you?" So that's the first time that's ever happened to me. So it was pretty weird, really. Yeah.
I used to get it when I worked on Galaxy for many years. As listeners always hear me harping on about my days on Galaxy Radio, and I used to get recognised quite a lot by the sound of my voice, but people would always be really disappointed.
Well, there is that as well, isn't there?
They're like, "What, you're Miranda? No, you don't look like that." And they'd be like, just didn't expect me to look how I did. So anyway, there we go. Ivan, absolutely wonderful to meet you. Absolutely delighted for you coming in today. Thank you so much. Happy birthday for BCFM on
happy
Sunday.
And also happy Mothering Sunday to you for Sunday.
Of course, it's Mothering Sunday. And the clocks go forward. Thank goodness for that. Ivan, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you. That was Ivan Jackson, presenter and broadcaster on BCFM Radio Bristol. Shout out. And goodness knows how many other radio stations. So that was wonderful. We're going to take a bit of a break, and coming back soon, we're going to meet Phoenix Liberty Rain, who is a model, athlete, trainer, and a behavioral coach. So what more? All in one person. Okay, we'll take a break and we'll see you soon.
The Word with Miranda, your information gateway.
And that was a very dramatic track called PTSD, and that was by America's number one independent hip-hop artist, none other than Tech N9ne. And that was produced also with a guy called JC, Joshua Castellano. He goes by the name JC. He's this young 19-year-old guy who actually wrote the track for Tech N9ne, and it was to kind of raise money for people who suffer with PTSD, particularly people who've been serving in the forces. They did a massive event in the States to raise awareness for post-traumatic stress disorder, which I don't mind admitting is something I sadly have experienced myself. We had a great meeting last night for the Sound Women Network at the BBC, and we had a couple of amazing guests. Countler Wolf, who used to be head of the BBC for 24 years and founder of 91 Ways, and she's written an incredible book called Spice Yourself Slim, which actually works, by the way. An incredible cookbook. And we also had international best-selling author, a survivor of cancer, and just all-round media guru, Amanda Prowse, speaking. And it was just an incredible night. Now, one of the ladies who came along last night is here joining me today, Phoenix Liberty Rain.
Hello.
And now, I would introduce you as a fitness and psychology coach. And your sort of aim is to strong women and powerful minds. Is that right?
Yeah, it is. So I've been in the fitness industry for quite a long time.
Have you?
Yeah. I've been working in the fitness industry since 2003. So what's like 13, 14 years now? Yeah. God, I feel old.
Don't look it.
Oh, thank
She's
you
absolutely
so much.
Stunning. Guys, you need to watch the video when it comes up online on YouTube. She's got these most incredible blue eyes. You need to zoom in on her eyes, Tom. They are absolutely beautiful.
Thank you so much. So I've been in the fitness industry a long time. I started doing all the usual stuff, started in a big personal training company, actually in Australia of all places, came back to England, worked in a few smaller studios, went the normal route that most coaches do.
Right.
And I think after a while doing that, you find your niche, everyone kind of starts out with general kind of weight loss or prenatal, whatever client comes their way. It's very hard to get started in fitness these
days. Do you specialise in women or do you train men as well?
Yeah, I only train women. I do train some men. The only men that I train are fitness professionals who are looking to get in shape for a certain reasons. So it's quite quite high level stuff. But I like to focus on women. That's where I specialise. Like, women's bodies are so different to men.
Right.
So different. We are not small versions of men, and you cannot apply the same methods that you would to a man for weight loss, for body recomposition, which is changing someone's body shape, so making them leaner, fitter, stronger, you know, more defined. We call that body recomposition. But we are not small versions of men, and it's a really different thing to work with a woman, work with her hormone cycles.
I've never even thought of it.
Yeah.
It seems really obvious now that you said it.
The cycles of a woman are vastly different. I mean, from woman to woman, they're different.
Yeah.
But even within the same woman, over a period of, say, a year, 2 years, 5 years, their cycles change so much. Yeah. And we have to then account for the fact that most women are on contraception. There's four generations of contraception. Within those four generations of contraception, we now have, like, vast differences. You've got the depot, you've got your injections, you've got your pill, you've got your IUD, your Mirena. Like, there's so much going on. And every one of those synthetic hormones affects the body in a different way. And every woman responds differently to all of those things. So it's really complicated.
Yeah, because some of these contraceptions can make you put on or lose weight, can't they?
Yeah.
And everybody can react differently.
Yeah.
So how is you, as a personal trainer, how would you know where to start?
it seems like a
massive enigma. I mean, okay, let's just take me. Okay, let's just take me. Now, look at... Okay, you don't know me very well, but let's go back sort of 10, 15 years ago. I was skinny, you know, and I didn't need to think about my weight at all. And then then you change, don't you? And then I became a mum, and then I got fat, you know, and I put on weight, and it just hasn't gone. And I look about how much I've changed over the years. As you're saying, a woman's body changes hugely, doesn't it? So how do you know where to start with each woman being so different?
Funnily enough, although everyone is so different in the way they present and their history and, you know, whether they've got children, how many children they've got, what job they do, are they active, are they up at night a lot, do they sleep well, all of those things have a massive impact on the body. However, when women come to me, we start at one place, and that is I get them off of dieting. I make them stop dieting. So everyone comes into me and they're like, oh, okay, I'm really excited to start my new program. What foods am I allowed to eat? I'm like, eat what you want.
Right, okay.
And that throws them. Can you imagine
going
into a personal training? I'm really excited. What am I going to do? I'm like, just eat whatever you want.
Right. Well, I don't believe in diets at all.
No.
I think it's all about having a healthy life, healthy mind. And, you can tell by the way I look that I don't believe in dieting. No, I'm joking. But no, I just think it's all about fitness, isn't it?
Yeah.
And that's how you can look after yourself.
There's a lot more to do with the psychology than it is to do with anything else. So the first thing that I do with my ladies is that I take away any restriction. So I give them choice and I give them freedom. And the power of that is unbelievable.
Yeah.
Because I'm saying to them, right, I want you to go away and eat three meals a day, two snacks, and if you want a glass of wine, if you want anything else, you can have it. I just want you to stick to the basics that I've told you, three meals, two snacks, and do the exercise. And within 3 days, they're like, I've never eaten so much. Why am I eating all this food? I'm like, just, are you feeling better? Yeah, I'm feeling better. Is your energy better? Yeah, my energy's great. How are your moods? I feel amazing. I'm like, okay, so now we have some adherence going on. You take them back to a baseline where they're feeling good about themselves. They're feeling stable with their moods. They've got energy. You know, their skin starts to improve a little bit. Just take them off the restriction. Most women have been dieting for like 15, 20 years. Can you imagine that?
15, yeah.
But most people that come into me and say, I've been on a diet for most of my life.
You're kidding.
I'm like, stop dieting.
Yeah. And when you say most women are dieting, does that mean that then they stop and they start, do you think? And that's the problem?
Yeah. Because they're so used to restriction. They want to punish themselves. Like, they want me to say to them, you're not allowed to have bread. You're not allowed to have carbs.
Right.
You're not allowed to have chocolate. You're not allowed to have cake. They want me to give them restriction and they want to feel punished. Which is crazy.
So this is why you get into the psychology of it all as well.
Yeah.
It must be a huge part of what you do, surely.
It's massive.
Yeah.
It's massive. I mean, I've been through quite a lot of stuff myself. We were talking about PTSD earlier on. I've been through PTSD. I've been treated for it. I've been through quite a lot of different treatments in my life. I've been for eating disorder treatment. PTSD treatment came later.
By the way, it's post-traumatic stress disorder, if you're out there wondering what it is about. I'm not going to go into all the reasons here why I have post-traumatic stress disorder, but it was a number of traumatic events that happened to me over a period of time, including my childhood, and it all came out in one. I don't know what your reasons are, but you know, the point is that you've had it. And how did you deal with it?
So I was very, very lucky. You know, it's one of those things where you think the universe has just conspired to help me. I was very fortunate. So I was dating a guy and I thought he was presenting with PTSD. He was ex-combat. And right. I phoned up, I started doing some research on Google, phoned up this guy who was doing some treatment for soldiers. And we're on the phone. He said, he is not the one that needs the treatment. I'm like, oh? He said, you are.
Oh, no.
I was like, oh, God, okay.
Really?
So he said, look, it's expensive and you'll need a referral, et cetera, et cetera. I said, well, I'm currently under referral for eating disorder, da, 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 da. And he said, look, I've got one charity place and I feel like you really need it. Have this charity place. So I went down to Cornwall. I was in lockdown on like rehab and got treated by a group of combat soldiers for PTSD. And that really was, I'd say that was the turning point that started my recovery.
Wow.
It was a long time ago.
That's absolutely incredible, because I've had experience of people in combat and a partner of mine who also suffered tremendous PTSD and from serving in the military and unfortunately took his own life. Mm. He couldn't get the support. He couldn't find anybody to support him. And it was very sad because he pushed everybody away that were trying to be there. So it's nice to hear that there are some places supporting people in combat. Was it specifically for people who were still serving or people who had left? Is it a private organisation? Just sounds interesting.
At that time, it was experimental.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was brand new. PTSD hadn't really been talked about.
No.
Do you remember the soldier, Martin Webster?
Yeah, of course.
So they went to Afghanistan and he was squadron leader. There was five of him in his, I don't know what you'd call it, unit or whatever.
Regiment,
They went out on operation and they were then tried with war crimes for doing their job. I think he went down for a couple of years and he went nuts.
Right.
So he's now a trained killer with PTSD.
Yeah, scary, isn't it?
Scary.
Yeah.
He went absolutely nuts, and the guy that was like at the, I'm not very good with army terms.
Don't worry.
So the guy that was at the top of his regiment, I don't know what they call it, was doing some work around PTSD and brought Martin in to do this experimental work. It was called spectrum therapy. It's now been delivered in the NHS.
Wow.
But I was one of the guinea pigs. Now, Martin went through it, and then 2 years later, he went through the treatment again because he was so badly damaged. But guess who was my therapist?
Martin.
I was treated by Martin Webster.
Wow. That's incredible, isn't it?
Yeah.
Absolutely incredible. And this is it's a real key point, is that, the Falklands War, that was one of the last close-up wars that we had where people were in close combat with each other. Nowadays, people, they fight at a distance. They're using long-term weapons, so you're not physically killing somebody in front of yourself. And it's very different. But the Falklands War was the last close-up combat where you saw your friends being blown up. I'm sorry if it's a bit explicit to listeners, but yeah, people losing limbs right in front of you. And that's why so many people who served in the Falklands have suffered from PTSD and an extraordinarily high suicide rate. And then you go on to the people that are serving now and in Iraq and the Gulf War syndrome. You know, it just goes on and on and on, the people who are affected. And what worries me is what you say is they are trained killers. And unfortunately, they're coming out and they're not getting the support that they need. So, yeah, it's great to hear about something like this. I could go on about that all day, but we're not here to talk about that. We're here to talk about you. So this has given you an incredible insight. So then did you go on and train yourself in psychology? How did you manage to to get that side to cover, you know, because you say you're a fitness and psychology trainer, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so what did you do?
Well, I've always been around it. My dad is a psychologist.
Right.
And my dad was, he was one of the best I mean, I'm biased, obviously. He was one of the best ones. He worked in the NHS in Stoke Park and Glenside Hospital. He ran those hospitals for, I think, like 40-odd years. He worked with the schizophrenics and the... can't remember what the other one was, but primarily schizophrenics and something else.
Schizophrenia?
Yeah,
whatever. Don't worry.
So I've been around it for a long time. You know, after school, he used to pick us up from school and then take us to the office, and we'd sit there with all the patients and watch a psychologist work. And, you know, my dad was like the boss, so like we'd walk in and out the wards and stuff. So I've always been around psychology. My dad actually said to me, "You are never going to be a psychologist. Do not go and do psychology." But what happened? I am my father's daughter. So, yeah, I went through a lot of treatment myself. I had the PTSD. I later on got diagnosed with ADHD, which seemed to kind of pin down everything. And I'd say that was the second turning point of my life. I've now been diagnosed with ADHD for like 4.5 years. I'm medicated and it has.
So remind us what ADHD is, if listeners.
So,
because I know a lot of children are diagnosed.
Yeah. So ADHD is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, which I have. ADD is kind of the overreaching definition, which is attention deficit disorder. Now, under that, there are 7 subtypes. So it's not a case of just not paying attention. It's quite a complicated thing, but it's a processing disorder. So you can see point A, you can see the end goal, but you have no idea how to get there. Yeah. And then there's things within that, like hyperactivity is a subtype, which I have. There is inattentive. There's also hyperfocus. So you can get so absorbed in one thing and be so attentive that you can't break that spell. Wow. So there's a lot in there. But yeah, I went through treatment with that with my consultant, which is kind of ongoing. And I decided to do my cognitive behavioral therapy qualification because it helped me a lot when I was going through all that, and I kind of self-guided myself through it. I started to use bits of it with my ladies when they were coming in, and they were telling me, I often get ladies that come to me that have had trauma because of my past, you know, or they've got some kind of disordered eating pattern going on. So I started to use some CBT with them, and it worked like nothing else has ever worked. Like it's better than any method of dieting or training, or, you know, you can give people all the information, but you can't change their behaviours unless you work on the behaviours.
So how would you go about that? How do you actually, what does it involve?
Oh, well, I don't give away all my secrets.
Yeah, but, you know, is it a case of talking to somebody? Yeah, is that basically what it's about?
So,
right, okay. Just to give us an idea for a listener out there and thinking, well, maybe this is something I can use. You know, it's not a case of electrical, you know, shock treatment. You know, it's a case of talking to somebody, and that's what it's about. That's cognitive treatment.
Yeah, in my first my first program that they come into is called the 9-day reverse detox. I should call it anti-detox, or I hate detox, or something like that, because there's nothing detox about it. That's the whole point.
Right.
It's about giving them stuff, adding stuff like nutrients, like water, like vitamins, adding relaxation time. I don't take anything away, so it's kind of anti-detox.
Yeah.
But what we do within that system is it's a 9-day education system. So I give them all of the knowledge that they've been missing. So then they can start piecing things together themselves. They can go, okay, I now understand if I eat this, this is the way the body's going to adapt. If I do this exercise, my body's going to adapt in this way. I'm going to feel like this. It's going to affect my hormones in this way, which is going to affect my thinking and my moods. And because they've got the education, when it then happens to them, they don't go, what on earth is happening? I'm going to go and binge on chocolate. They go, oh, I know. I know what's going on. And now I know I can manage it. It's like magic.
It is. It is like magic.
They call me the White Witch. They do. They all call me the witch.
Yeah, no, it's absolutely incredible. So your focus now is helping women, you say. Mm-hmm. Where do you do this? Where are you based? How do people find you?
I'm online. Yeah. So all of my programs are online. I do a little bit of face-to-face, but not too much.
Oh, really? So yeah. It's predominantly online?
It's all online.
How interesting.
Yeah, yeah. I've been training online since 2007.
So does that mean when you include, okay, you've got the psychology side as well, and you presumably do the fitness therapy as well, training. Mm-hmm. So you're FaceTiming people? How does
it
work?
No, it's all videos. So, it's all coaching videos. So they get all of their, they get full workouts, which are start to finish on video, DVD, or whatever.
Yeah.
They get all of the coaching videos. So it's all set up in a format. So it's day one, here's your exercise video for the day.
But how does it work if, like, say, somebody who hasn't exercised in 10 years, not looking at anybody in particular... How? So then we have to work out a different program for everybody, surely?
It's stackable. Stackable. So at the beginning, like I said, it's a 9-day education system. It's primarily about educating them, getting them into good habits. And I've never had anyone come in to me that has not been able to do the 9-day program. So is that mine? That's not mine, is it?
I've got no idea. Don't pretend it's not there.
It is my school alarm.
It's all right. We just ignore it. You're late. Have you got to do the school run?
No, it's all right.
Oh, Dad's doing it,
yeah,
is he?
He's doing it today.
Oh, that's okay, because we did discuss that. Yeah. No, I always set my alarm at 2:50 in case I forget. Who's going to forget? You never do. Well, never forgotten, but there you go.
With our jobs, you know, you're always kind of one place to the other, aren't you?
No, but do you know what? There's probably about 100 other thousand women all at the same time with the phones going off at the moment. So there, it's all good.
Yeah.
Where were we? Stackable.
Yeah, so you can start with, I think the first program, the 9-day program, starts with like 4 minutes of exercise. Or it might be 6 minutes. So the minimum.
The 4 minutes is plenty.
Yeah, so you can start with 4 minutes, but you can also stack that. So if you're coming in, I've got a lot of fitness professionals that work with me as well. So I've got some Pilates teachers, I've got personal trainers, I've got all sorts.
So why do they need to work with you?
It's very hard to coach yourself.
Right.
It's very hard to coach yourself. And I think in the fitness industry particularly, especially if you're a personal trainer or you're a fitness instructor where you're teaching a lot of classes, the last thing you want to do is go in and teach another class. But teaching classes doesn't give you what you need for your training.
It doesn't not.
No.
Oh, I
see.
No,
because you're mainly...
Because you think if somebody's teaching all day long, they're going to be super fit. So why would they then need to do it themselves?
No, it doesn't work like doesn't that,
it?
Unfortunately.
Ah.
So, everybody needs a coach. I mean, I have a coach. My coach is the other side of the world, but I have a coach. all the best coaches have a coach.
So how often do you train yourself?
About 5 days a week.
5 days a week? For how long?
2 hours... Four days a week I do 2 hours, and then on the fifth day it's normally some cardio.
And so what kind of training do you do? Is it weight training?
You lift weights, don't you?
Because we haven't got much time, but I really wanted to talk to you about this because you feel quite strongly about this as well, about how people train with weights and that they have this image of then being bulky muscle women, and it's not the case, is it?
No.
Tell me why.
I can lift 2 times my body weight.
And look how petite and sweet and beautiful she is. Yeah.
I'm really small. I lift more than most of the guys in my gym. So, you know, I'm in there on a Monday morning and they're taking off the weights that I've used.
Yeah.
So it's not, you know, women just don't have the capacity to get really big and bulky. Unless you've got things going on like maybe PCOS where you've got like a higher testosterone level. You know, there's different things. But mostly women cannot get big and bulky unless you're, you know, injecting steroids or whatever.
Of course. I see. Okay. Okay. So, but you feel quite strongly about that it can help women in a big way, don't you?
So this is my new campaign that I'm starting. So Strong Women, Powerful Minds, where I am campaigning to get every woman in the gym lifting weights. So every woman should be in the gym lifting weights. Like one of my friends, Gina, she's an adaptive martial artist, and the amount of weight she lifts...
But why do you think we are all anti-weights? Because we think it's going to make us muscly?
Well, I think it's just the society we live in is misogynistic.
Yeah.
You know, it's misogynistic and it's inherently racist, as we know.
Yeah, yeah.
And from that comes our ideal perception of what a woman should look like.
Right.
And we've got that in our heads, and we've got these things are going, don't lift weights, don't lift weights. Women should be dainty. Women should be frail, feminine. And it's rubbish. Women should be strong. We should be powerful. We should be able to carry our kids and, you know, have the energy to do all the things that we have to do these days, work a full-time job, look after the kids, look after the house.
Yeah.
We need to have strong bodies.
You're amazing. Phoenix, I am just sat in awe listening to you today. I just, I just hope that I can meet you outside of the studio one day.
And, absolutely.
You know, I can't ever imagine being fit. That's the bottom line. I lost it 10 years ago, psychologically, physically, my life. Although the best thing happened to me and I had my son, you know, everything else, the awful happened to me around then. And I've never pulled myself back
I'll
out of
what,
that again.
I'll tell you what, it's so easy to get it back. People have this fear of it. It's not scary.
Yeah. Well, Phoenix, we'll talk more. Let's get you back in the studio more often. I think we could do that. We should do some phone-ins, get the listeners calling
in
with some questions. Wouldn't that be good?
Yeah.
So, Phoenix Liberty Rain, thank you so much for joining me today.
Woo-hoo!
Thank you. Bye, darling. Oh, what an incredible woman. I was just absolutely enthralled. It's so interesting to hear all those different things, isn't it? Right. We've got more guests. We've got coming up next, we have Dr. Marie Mulvie-Roberts, who's an author and lecturer at UWE, and she's kind of a bit of an expert on Angela Carter, so we're going to speak about her shortly. We better take a break, pay the bills, we'll be back soon. You're listening to The Word on Ujima.
The Word with Miranda, your information gateway.
Absolutely love that track. I'm never going to get tired of it. That's by Suchi, and it's called Stargazer. And of course, Suchi is a homegrown Bristol artist, so yeah, absolutely loving that track. You're listening to The Word on Ujima 98 FM. Hi, I'm Miranda. Thanks for joining me today. We've got about, 38 minutes left of the show. What a great show we've had. Wasn't Phoenix amazing? And do you know what her son's called? River. I know. How cool is that? Right, so moving on. We are now joined by Associate Professor of English, Dr. Marie Mulvie-Roberts. Hi, Marie.
Hi.
Thank you so much for joining me today. You're an author, lecturer at University of the West of England, and some might say a bit of an expert on Angela Carter.
Well, so it's said.
Yeah, yes. Absolutely. Yeah. And you also work with the lovely Charlotte Crofts, who's been in a number of times on the show. She's an Associate Professor of Filmmaking up UWE as well. Yeah. Now you work together in particularly interested in an author of a seminal author, English seminal author,
absolutely
Angela Carter.
Yes, indeed. One of the greatest writers of the 20th century. And what's so fabulous for us is that she spent a lot of time in Bristol. And what isn't very widely known is that she actually wrote 5 of her 9 novels while she was living in Bristol in the 1960s. And yet, you know, people kind of think of her as a London writer.
Well, absolutely. I mean, I had no idea she had anything to do with Bristol. You're very aware of her being London-based, evacuated to Yorkshire in the war. Mm. But yeah, it's not noted at all. So how much time did she spend here? And how influential do you think the city was on her writing?
Well, she was here for most of the 1960s.
Really?
She arrived in 61 and left in 69.
How old would she have been at that point, roughly?
Well, she was quite young because she... was a student at Bristol University. She might have been a slightly mature student because she was working as a journalist a bit before that. But, you know, it's a very formative time in her life. And in fact, it was in Bristol where she wrote her very first novel, Shadow Dance. And she wrote 3 novels that have become known as the Bristol Trilogy because they're actually set in the city. And it's quite exciting reading her books and figuring out the landmarks.
Oh, really?
Because one of the characters goes to the Bristol City Museum and is standing in front of the gypsy caravan and an Irish elk. And she lived in Clifton, and Clifton was the setting then, and it was quite a rundown area in those days, in fact. So we get a very different view of the Clifton we now know.
Oh, that is interesting. I think if we could just get a little bit of a background for maybe some listeners who's Angela Carter.
Perhaps
you could explain to us who she is and why she's so important.
Yes. Well, one of the things about her now is that she's actually on the A-level syllabus and sometimes on the GCSE syllabus. And her most well-known text, which is taught, is The Bloody Chamber. And this is an amazing collection of her adaptations of short stories, but of fairy tales specifically. And I think she's most well known for that. But she's a lot more than that. She's written quite a few novels. She's also written libretto for an opera. She's done screenplays, done all sorts of things, and also written poetry, which has only recently come to light. And of course, she was writing that when she was in Bristol. So Bristol's been a really important place for Carter, where she sort of cultivated her talent and honed her writing skills.
Yeah, and it says that she's kind of updates fairy tales and, you know, made fairy tales psychological and sexy. Yes. Is that how you feel?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, they're fairy tales for adults, absolutely. And I recently co-curated with Fiona Robinson an exhibition at the RWA. And on the last day of the exhibition, which was Sunday, I did a reading from her vampire tale, The Lady of the House of Love, and it's a rewrite of the Sleeping Beauty story with a vampire twist. But she just writes like nobody else. She is so unique, and what struck me about her writing is that it's so visual, which gave me the idea of having an exhibition in an art gallery in the 25th year since she died. So we are doing a lot of events around that commemoration, and Charlotte Croft and I have put together this website called getangelacarter.com, and that's got...
As in Git Carter.
Absolutely.
I like that. I did absolutely. Get that. That's yeah, very clever.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. But also, you know, not everybody gets Angela Carter either. No. So we're hoping that this will help people get her and like her and read her work and just see what an amazing writer she is. And she's also very political. She's very radical,
feminist.
Subversive,
yep.
Feminist.
Yep.
And just makes you think about the world differently. And I think we'll get people to think about Bristol differently as the place where it all started.
How do you think it'll make people think about Bristol differently?
Well, I think one of the things I'm really interested in is engaging with Bristol's literary heritage in a wider way. I've got a project called Mapping Literary Bristol, and I've gathered together about 100 really significant writers, and Angela Carter's just one of those. I did a book a couple of years ago called Literary Bristol, Writers and the City, and one of my colleagues at UWE, Zoe Brennan, she wrote a chapter on Angela Carter and the Bristol Trilogy as a sort of bohemian look at the dark underbelly, the gothic underbelly of Bristol. So that's a side to Bristol that perhaps we can be reminded about. And I did a chapter in the book called Gothic Bristol. So I see Bristol as a sort of gothic place, and I teach gothic literature at UWE.
Oh, fascinating. Yeah. What are your favourite gothic buildings in Bristol?
Well, I think that the Mary Redcliffe is the gothic building. But, you know, Bristol University has got a modern gothic building, you know, with a tower there. But also the Bristol's associated with some major gothic novels, such as Frankenstein and Dracula, surprisingly, which isn't widely known. And, of course, Angela Carter is a gothic writer.
Of course.
And so it all fits together. She seems to be part of a continuation of a tradition of not just literary Bristol, but gothic literary Bristol as well.
Do you think that's just because it was fashionable? Or what do you think it's just... I'm wondering why so many authors are interested in that. Or is it just that magical realism that gives them that chance to really express their imagination? Yeah. What do you think?
Well, I think it's because the way I'm picking them out and I'm seeing their gothic elements, so I'm kind of being very selective in that kind of way. But I mean, Bristol was such an important city throughout its history, and it attracted writers, you know, with Hotwell's Spa across its history. And as we know, there's the Romantic poets that are associated with Bristol. You know, Wordsworth and Coleridge were supposed to have met at the Georgian House. And then, of course, we've got all those great seafaring novels associated with Bristol, such as Treasure Island, Robinson Crusoe. And in fact, Gulliver started his journey from Bristol on the way to Lilliput.
You're obviously very aware of this, and you're saying, of course, and obviously. And it's like, I've absolutely no idea. I had absolutely no idea. So, you know, I guess that must... Do you find that frustrating when you talk to somebody and think, oh, my God, she hasn't got a clue?
Oh, not at all. I think it's exciting to be able to say to people that you've got this amazing heritage. And that's, you know, why I did the book, Literary Bristol, to draw attention to that. And also, you know, this Mapping Literary Bristol project is going to do the same kind of thing too.
Well, that's great. I want to find out more. I want to know about Dracula and Frankenstein in Bristol, but we've got to take a break for the news. So we're speaking to Associate Professor of English at the University of the West of England. It's Dr. Marie Mulvie-Roberts, bit of an expert on Angela Carter. So we're just going to go over to the studios at the BBC for the latest headline news, and we'll be back shortly.
The Word with Miranda, your information gateway.
Absolutely love that track. That's Malkovich and a track entitled Reset. We're cutting it short because I've got too much I want to talk about. You're listening to The Word on Ujima, and we've got a wonderful guest in this afternoon. I want to make the most of her. It's the Associate Professor of English at University of the West of England. It's Dr. Marie Mulvie-Roberts. Welcome back, Marie.
Hi.
Thank you so much for joining me today. We were just talking whilst the news was on, and you created an exhibition recently. Tell the listeners what it's about.
Yes. Well, this was a major exhibition at the Royal West of England Academy in Bristol, and it ran for 3 months, and it actually closed on Sunday. But if you've missed it, you can always look at the catalogue. It was called Strange Worlds, The Vision of Angela Carter. And it was a way of engaging with Angela Carter's work through art. And we divided the exhibition up into contemporary art, which my co-curator Fiona Robinson dealt with, and I dealt with the historical work, the loans from the galleries, and artifacts and manuscripts and things like that. And we put this together. I mean, it's been 7 years in the making to get to it, and wow. I think we've just had the most amazing response to it. But I read all of Angela Carter's work and picked out references to art and artists, and then tried to get a sort of narrative running through the exhibition. So our big coup really was getting a Chagall Blue Circus, because Angela Carter's written a novel called Nights at the Circus, and she has this character called Feathers, who is a trapeze artist only with real wings. So we had to get things with circus themes. So it was fantastic to bring this Chagall to Bristol. And we also had to get a fairy painting, because she writes about Midsummer Night's Dream. And we had a magnificent, wonderful, huge canvas of Victorian fairy painting. And Angela Carter actually described fairy paintings of Victorians as a sort of pornography of the imagination. And Lewis Carroll actually counted in this particular painting that we had by Joseph Noel Paton from Midsummer Night's Dream. He counted 165 naked fairies. So I think the Victorians were getting their frisson, getting their kicks from that. And so it's a stunning painting. But really where the idea started for having an exhibition on Carter at an art gallery was because she did an art film called The Holy Family Album, and it was looking at the life of Christ through religious painting, as if they're photographs in God's album. And she's made this sort of surrealist art film. They tried to ban it. It was very controversial. We managed to get three paintings from the from the film, which was fantastic. And one of them was the Holman Hunt, the Shadow of the Cross. Absolutely beautiful painting.
I've just shown it to the camera. You'll be glad to hear. Because whilst you're talking, I'm showing a few pictures to the camera. You've got to watch this episode, guys, on YouTube if you're listening. It's going to be awesome.
Yeah, because the one we got next to it was Arnulf Rayner's The Wine Crucifix. And it's really kind of gruesome, because it's like a slash of blood.
Yeah, I've seen it. And it's absolutely incredible. It's so
like,
powerful.
It's like the cross. The shadow is now realized into the actual death. And the other painting we got was a Stanley Spencer, and of course an artist who had lived and worked in Bristol during the war. And that was a very irreverent look at the wedding at Cana, Jesus' first miracle. And in fact, the focus is on the bride's bottom, because he eroticized his religious painting, and Carter would have appreciated that. So you've got a sort of theme of water into wine, and then wine and blood running through those three paintings. But we looked at other. We had a fantastic hologram of Ophelia, where it's called the Drowned Ophelia, done by a wonderful duo in Bristol called Kirsten and Davy Maguire. And Kirsten's a dancer, and she I saw her her playing the part of Lucy in a Dracula ballet, and you can see her writhing under the water as if she's drowning, the bubbles coming through. And Angela Carter was fascinated by John Everett Millais' Ophelia, and in her third novel in her Bristol trilogy called Love, the heroine is an artist also obsessed by Ophelia, and a bit of a spoiler here because she commits suicide like Ophelia. And Angela Carter used to have posters of Ophelia on her wall when she lived in Bath, because the other place that's important is Bath. She lived there in the 70s and she wrote a lot of The Bloody Chamber there. So, you know, she could be seen really as a West Country writer.
Absolutely, and people forget that as well. And Company of Wolves, yes. That of course is Angela Carter as well, isn't it?
Yes, yeah, yes. I'm glad you mentioned that, because in the exhibition, in one of the display cases, there's the original magazine in which it was published before it was actually published in the Bloody Chamber.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So, and we've got other things in the exhibition which are really fascinating and very little known, because Angela Carter was very big on the folk scene when she was in Bristol. Her husband Paul was a producer, and they were part of the 1960s folk scene revival, which was very political and radical in its day. And we've got the only known recording of her singing, which you can hear over headphones, and also manuscripts of her having notated music. And you could say that her interest in fairy tales really came out of that folk tradition in many ways, because when she left Bristol and the marriage, she also left the folk scene, but she started working on another oral tradition, which was the folk tale and the fairy tale. So you can see that Bristol has a real role to play there. And when she was a student at Bristol University studying English, her dissertation was on a folk song. So it was a very important part of her life, and one that's been really neglected and forgotten. But, you know, we managed in the exhibition and in the catalogue to really enshrine that and bring that to people's attention.
I've been flicking through the catalogue, and it isn't a catalogue. It's an absolute work of art. There's literally beautiful paintings, disturbing artwork, incredibly powerful images. The one of the banquet.
Oh, that's incredible. Yes, the Anna Maria Vichega.
Absolutely amazing.
That took the entire room, and in fact, it had to be specially painted a special grey. And it's quite terrifying with these figures.
Yes,
with these giant. I mean, they're larger than life with these enormous heads.
Really?
And we have this body stretched out called the banquet, and with very strong implications of cannibalism and incest, which Angela Carter said were the two great themes of the Gothic.
And
the other thing about in the catalogue is there's also essays of people that remembered her, because I really wanted to record reminiscences of her from people like, you know, Carmen Khalil, who actually writes the preface, who was her publisher at Virago, Christopher Frayling, and Marina Warner, some you know, very
brilliant
people.
We are very nearly running out of time. You've got a wonderful website called getangelacarter.com, which we spoke about, but this so-called catalogue, which is actually the most beautiful book I've seen in ages. If people out there want to have a look at it, how do they get hold of it?
Well, if they go onto our website, there is a link to it. They can find that on getangelacarter.com.
It is
straight to publisher.
Beautiful. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. It's literally a work of art. I'm now just mortified that I didn't get to come to the exhibition. What a shame. And it finished on Sunday.
I know. I wish it had gone on a bit longer, really, but we had 3 months.
Three months is pretty good. Because there's the picture of, we've literally have got a few seconds, but the lady that had the heart around
the necklace.
And then there's the image with the tongue. Is that the tongues?
Right. Yes, it is. It
That's
is.
That's just wrong.
Yes.
She's a necklace of tongues. But it's just incredibly
powerful.
Well,
she's an Irish artist, and that represent the silencing of women.
No, I get that, and that's why it's so powerful, isn't it? The imagery is just incredible.
Most of the artists were women, very unusually. Over three quarters of the artists in the exhibition. Yeah.
Oh, well, that's brilliant. So, oh, listen, we can talk all day, but we can't. We've run out of time. Dr. Anna Marie Mulvie-Roberts, thank you so much for coming in today. It's been an absolute privilege talking to you.
Oh, thank you, Miranda. It's been wonderful talking to you too.
Thank you. Wow, how absolutely amazing. I now know more about Angela Carter than I did half an hour ago. And obviously a very passionate subject for yourself
that,
as well.
And that's my literary Bristol book as well.
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay. So, yes, I spoke about you being an author, and you've written the book, Literary Bristol, about the writers in the city, which again really surprised me about. Yeah. I had no idea.
The pictures are lovely, actually. Yeah. They've got lovely colour plates.
All right. Well, listen, let's take a break and we'll have a look. Lovely. You're listening to The Word on Ujima. We've only got a few minutes left, so don't go anywhere.
This is G-Product, Full Cycle Records, and I always keep it locked to The Word with Miranda. Ujima, 98 FM.